Alright, man. I'll see you later.
I am from New York, originally from Jamaica. I came here as a kid. Everything was pretty much new to me. And in school, I would get in a lot of trouble. It wasn't my fault. I was getting picked on. I didn't understand it. It was new to me. So, mom brought me to a psychiatrist, and immediately the guy looked through me. He was like, you got no confidence. And miraculously, when we were leaving, a martial arts school was next door. And that's when I started, and it took over ever since. So it's pretty much changed my life.
What do you think about the tough finale? You have obviously Uriah. I don't know, he kind of went in there. I thought he showboated a little too much, and it cost him.
See, I didn't think he showboated. I think he mentally broke. I think that you saw what he had in this season, but what you find when you find out what a guy really has is when he's under pressure. When you're under pressure is when you find out who the Anderson Silvas and the George St. Pierres are. You know, those type of guys. He's got a lot of skills, and his wrestling looked good tonight. I mean, everything looked good tonight. He just got to work on his head. I just told him that. You got to get that head straight, man. You need to become meaner. You're not mean enough.
Did you see any conflict?
I don't really care about the belt. The belt is symbolic, and don't get me wrong, I'm not trying to, say anything wrong about these champions. But without that belt, they're still champions. And in the martial arts background, I remember as a brown belt beating black belts. I used to ask my sensei, why am I beating these guys? They're supposed to be black belts. And again, it was a psychological thing to say, they're supposed to be better than me.
There's no right being in there with you. No right.
So I was already talking myself out of my, my confidence. And my sensei said, the belt doesn't mean anything. It's what you have. It's what you know.
He most certainly has a broken foot.
Adrenaline is a great painkiller.
I threw a kick in the first round, I remember, and I felt like a sting. And, if you watch the fight again, I looked down, and I saw my toe on the other side. I was like, all right, it's broken. And then we just both kind of gave each other the nod. I didn't know if he knew my toe was broken, so I kept kicking with it.
It's amazing how tough Uriah Hall is.
I had to do that, because psychologically, I didn't know. And if he had saw that, he probably would have stepped on it.
Uriah!
When you're outside of your comfort zone, life begins. We only get to do this once. So you don't want to be regretting anything later on in life saying, I wish I had done this. What's the difference from someone that's very successful? The only difference is they want a little more. They refuse to say, all right, I'm not just gonna back out. I'm just gonna keep going. If I fail, I get back up.
If life knocks you in the face, punches you, take you back down, you get up and you say, you hit like a bitch. So I had to get back up and say, you hit like a bitch.
Jumbo Shane's hearse. That'll do it. Uriah Hall stopping the show early once again.
See how long it takes for
him. Oh, right in the face. And now finally, Uriah Hall is going to defeat Musashi. He's got him rocked. A spinning attack to the face of Gegard Mousasi.
Looked like maybe the referee had made contact with Hall. That'll do it. Uriah Hall has done it. He comes to Japan and stuns Gegard Mousasi.
Unbelievable.
Robert Whittaker is a great opportunity. He's one of the best. He's young, he's hungry. I like going up against guys with that type of skill set. It kind of brings the best out of me.
I'm really looking forward to this fight. I have a lot of respect for Uriah's skill sets before finish, and I expect a hard fight. I expect a fun fight. There's going to be some real fireworks.
He says fireworks. I don't know about fireworks, because I'm going to knock you out before all that. It's going to be my night because it's my destiny.
It's such a big event, possibly 70,000 people, who knows. Why are you so relaxed?
Because it's another day. You know, the environment changed, but the act doesn't. You know, just because it's a big arena and all that stuff, I'm not going to get freaked out. I know what I'm here to do. I'm here to clock in and clock out.
I was born in Jamaica, 1984, and came to America in New York City, 1997. Of course, upon arrival, you know, you're in a new city, concrete jungle, they call it. And I didn't know much. I didn't even know what racism was, and I was bullied. I didn't know how to handle that, and it was a constant thing, so I would get into fights, not even knowing how to fight. I think for me, the lowest of the low of getting bullied was I was going home on the school bus, and was a bunch of kids on the bus, of course, and there was this one bully. And when he got on the bus, he's like, "You ugly, right?" Like as if I was supposed to agree to it. So I just looked the other way because I was told that's what I was supposed to do. And he beat me up. He literally beat the living daylights out of me. He beat me up so bad that another bully had to jump in and tell him to stop. And I remember getting off the bus, humiliated. My mother decided to put me in martial arts to build my confidence. I walked in, decided to sign up. The rest was history. That time in my life, that chapter, you know, it sucked. There were dark times where I contemplated suicide. Martial arts definitely saved my life. Looking back now, I'm thankful for all the stuff I've been through. Even the bullies, you know, they mold me into who I am. I've gotten better from it. I look back and I take all the good I can from it. I look at all the negative and I just put it where it needs to be.
I want this more. I want this so bad because a lot of these guys, they come out here and like, well, if this doesn't work out, I got this. Me, I got so much to gain. And I don't think I have anything to lose. I really don't. But sometimes you lose that confidence, and when you lose it, it's like a little drop of poison, man. You let that one little doubt go in your head, and it just affects everything else.
We're done, man.
You know, I wanted to ask you a personal question. Yeah. I have a constant struggle battling myself.
That's what I was surprised.
I think at one point in my career, I just lost a lot of confidence. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I have people saying, oh, man, yeah, you're this, you're that. It's different when they see it. But if you don't see it for yourself, I don't think it's worth nothing.
Yeah, I could finish every sentence that you were about to say. Here's the biggest thing that happened to me is I had lost, you know, X amount of fights by submission in the second round, right around 7 minutes of the fight, dominated up till then. I go, this just isn't physical. I got a mental problem, and I'm finding out where it's happening. So I treat it like an alcoholic, where, you know, the first thing I had to do was admit I got a problem and ask for help. And I went in and saw a guy, a sports psychology guy. One of the huge things that I realized that everybody's going through it. I used to think there was something wrong with me. I used to be really embarrassed about it. And, you know, I talked to Randy Couture about it. And Randy said that the one thing that he learned is that he could never defeat it. He could never defeat the second guessing or the negative voice in his head. And that he just learned, I just got to learn to compete with it. I can't kill this off. I got to compete with it.
When doubt seeps in, you got two roads. You can take either road. You can go to the left or you can go to the right. And believe me, you know, they'll tell you failure is not an option. That is ridiculous. Failure is always an option. Failure is the most readily available option at all times, but it's a choice. You can choose to fail, you can choose to succeed. And if we can plant seeds and let him know, move your feet, keep your hands up, stay off the bottom, that is the road to victory. Or self-doubt and negative talk, and that is the road to failure. But failure is always there, and it's okay to recognize that.
I mean, if I can leave you with anything today in my own journey through this, it's one, it's okay, and two, it's normal. And as athletes, and especially as men, as male athletes, we hate to admit weakness, even to ourselves. And when you're dealing with something, you get some kind of a hiccup, yeah, first thing, acknowledge it, like you just did.
Go back now, I am looking for free. This fight, do you think this is the biggest fight of your career with Anderson Silva?
Yeah, it's one of the biggest fights. Anderson Silva is a legend, so I'm just excited to go out there and up against the guy that I watched growing up. You know, to me, I made it. That's how you gotta look at it.
And to find it cost me everything I have.
Say to you that you could be the champion one day, of course, after that performance. And the champ is in the house. I mean, map out the perfect road to fighting Izzy for the championship. Do you think you deserve it now, or do you think you need a couple of fights?
You know what? I've been in the sport for a long time. I feel like I solidified my mark. There's an up and down, whatever you want to say. Anyone can say whatever they want, man. I'm in the best gym in the world. I can't tell you how solid I feel working with Safe and the mindset I've developed. If I could be honest, man, I was out. I was like, man, I don't care about this stuff anymore because of the politics. But just being that environment with him and all the coaches and the team, I feel like I'm exactly where I need to be. And I definitely know I could take on the champ. In the meantime, if the UFC want to give me someone, or if they think they can send someone to beat me, that's not a problem. My goals are set, and it remains the same, to be world champ.